The following presentation is from PBS Home Video.
Innovative programs, challenging concepts, and quality family entertainment. This is the world of PBS Home Video. New critically acclaimed programs are now available at prices that make it affordable to add PBS Home Video to your permanent collection. Through it all, you'll discover quality programs that your family will enjoy for years to come. PBS Home Video, bringing the world alive with award-winning programs guaranteed to change the way you look at home entertainment. To receive a free catalog or to order PBS Home Video, call 1-800-776-8300. This program is made possible by a grant from Primerica, a family of financial companies, including Smith Barney Investment Services, Primerica Financial Services, Term Insurance and Mutual Funds, and Commercial Credit, Personal and Real Estate Loans.
Let's face it, if he dares come across that border and come down here, I'm completely confident that we're going to kick his butt.
General Norman Schwarzkopf, talking with his troops.
The big wretched was where girl.
That about 2 years ago, the most we've ever seen.
We had asked the general to share with us the story of the war, as only he can tell it. The whole of our interview took place four floors below the Saudi Ministry of Defense in the war room, command center for all Allied operations. Inevitably, our conversation began with the man, Saddam Hussein. What was the psychological profile you were working to? Were you assuming this man is clever and cunning, or crazy like a fox? I mean, what was your psychological profile of your adversary? Do you think he's mad?
I don't think he's mad. I think that he, Someone once asked me, what's the difference between me and Saddam Hussein? The answer is, I have a conscience and he doesn't. If you look at the way he has risen to power, it has been over dead bodies and murders, and I think he has no, absolutely no conscience, no regard for human life, and views the taking of human life as just one more step in his progress to the top. I think he's a megalomaniac. Now, maybe the maniac part means that there's a certain degree of madness there, but I don't think he's mad. I just think he absolutely had illusions of grandeur as the next Nebuchadnezzar, and he was going to be the unifier of the Arab world, but that Arab world was going to be unified under his conditions with him at the top.
And a man who has no conscience is another way of saying you really regarded him as evil in a way.
Oh, I think there's no question about it. In my mind, he is an evil man.
Can you remember the moment when you first realized that your future was going to be inextricably linked with that of Saddam Hussein's? It was a phone call from General Colin Powell, wasn't it?
Yes. At the time, I just completed a workout, and I was in my workout gear, and the phone rang, the hotline from Colin Powell. And he was on the phone, and he said, well, you were right, they crossed the border. And I said, yeah, gee, I really, you know, really thought they would. Now, at that time, I didn't think I was going to be inextricably involved with Saddam Hussein, because I really, and I think everybody else thought that they would go down, take the Ramallah and then stop right there and then use that as a bargaining chip. And then we were started monitoring the situation. I immediately changed my clothes and got ready to go to work. And of course, then the next phone call I got from Colin was, well, they're now, we've just got reports that they're in downtown Kuwait. That made it an entirely different situation. Of course, we then went on to the 24-hour business. But I think the time when I really, really knew was over here in Riyadh, because Secretary Cheney and I were sent over here by the president
To talk to King Fahd.
To talk to King Fahd. And I think, at least I know what my expectations were. My expectations were we would brief King Fahd. We would tell him what the situation was and the real danger to Saudi Arabia. The president's message was very clear, and that's if asked to defend Saudi Arabia, we would. We would also leave when asked to leave, and we wouldn't establish any permanent bases. And I think that based upon the decision-making processes as we'd seen them over here before, I was quite sure in my own mind anyhow that we'd been told, thank you very much, I now need to confer with my advisors, and the king would tell us this, and then he would subsequently give us an answer. Instead, after a discussion, the king said, fine, we want you to come. And that at that moment, then I knew we were more than involved. We were committed at that time.
We were committed at that point. And at that point, really, when we drew the line in the sand, when the president drew the line in the sand at the beginning, that first line was in defense of
yes.
Saudi Arabia. Yeah. It developed into liberating Kuwait after that, didn't it?
Yeah.
And so do you think, in fact, that Saddam Hussein would have attacked Saudi Arabia without that strong response? And I suppose that was one of his first mistakes, because if he had moved straight in and taken Dhahran, he would have presented us with a really serious problem.
Yeah, very true. I don't think there's any question at all that he would have eventually attacked Saudi Arabia. I don't know whether he would have done it exactly at that moment or a week later, but subsequently, just the amount of ammunition, for instance, that we have found just north of the Kuwaiti border, the amount of supplies that were pre-positioned there is far in excess of anything anyone ever would have needed for either to attack Kuwait or to defend Kuwait. So obviously, I think we're all pretty well convinced that he had greater aims than just taking Kuwait.
But if you'd been running his military operation, which thank God you weren't, would you have said, go straight in there before the Americans or anyone else can respond? Go straight from Kuwait, straight in and take Dhahran?
Yeah, there's no question about it that militarily that would have been the course of action. You see, I think that probably the major miscalculation on the part of Saddam and his military is they never thought that the free world would care if Kuwait was taken. I think they thought that the timetable was of their choosing, and therefore they could go in and take Kuwait and then subsequently take the oil fields of Saudi Arabia without anyone ever caring. And of course, that was probably the reason why they thought that they had all the time in the world when they really didn't.
Actually, we touched on one other mistake already too, haven't we? In the sense that if he had just gone in and taken the oil field and Babayan and Warba or one of them, it might have been much more difficult to get the world together to stop him, might it?
Sure. But let's just stop and think. He would have taken, just a few kilometers inside the border. I think that probably there were many people in the Gulf at that time that would have agreed that was a proper thing to do, because Kuwait was really almost by itself as far as OPEC was concerned and regarding the price of oil. But so if he had done that, I think that where you'd see him today is with his entire armed forces intact, sitting there in control of the Ramalia oil field, sitting there in control of Boubian, but more importantly, having taken that slight aggressive step, he would really be a major threatening power for the entire rest of the Gulf to have to contend with. So I guess my, from a political military standpoint, he really would have been able to dominate the Gulf for many, many years to come by just stopping after taking the Ramalia oil fields. And so he really made absolutely a strategic miscalculation of major order.
When did you give your first briefing to the president? You said in a quote recently that the first advice you gave him was dreadful because you said it would take much longer and take many more people,
yeah,
and so on. When was that? When was that briefing?
Let me see. The invasion was on Thursday, I guess, and that was on. I gave an initial briefing in the White House on Thursday morning. I gave another briefing at the Camp David on the following Saturday. Now, my briefing to the president was, in fact, how we would defend Saudi Arabia. It was our operations plan that we had worked on for over a year and a half. The entire briefing was on the defense of Saudi Arabia. But the very last slide in that briefing was, oh, by the way, you know, in the event that we changed our objectives from one of defending Saudi Arabia to one of taking him on offensively, here is his offensive capability, and therefore it's going to require many, many, many more troops than we currently plan to deploy if it's approved, and furthermore, it will take a lot longer than what I'm showing you in terms of the timelines for the defense. I had briefed him on the forces and the timelines for the defense, and my only point was to illustrate that offensive was a lot different than defense.
Right.
However, I will admit that I'd said at that time, you know, when, and that was, you know, that it would require many more forces and a lot more time, and that was based purely upon a very, very simplistic military analysis of all the factors involved.
When you came to work out the great Hail Mary stroke left hook or whatever plan, was that your second or your third strategy? Because there were reports that at the beginning of October you had a different plan.
Is that true
or not?
No, that's not true. I'm glad you asked that question. Let me lay this one to rest forever. The forces that we had sent over here were forces that were purely designed for the defense of Saudi Arabia. It was the capability that was required to defend. It was far less than those forces that we needed to, in fact, eject them from Kuwait. But at the same time, by that time, it had been announced that by one of the United Nations resolutions, that the ultimate resolution was, you know, to eject Iraqi forces from Kuwait, or I think it was to cause the withdrawal. So at that time, the strategy was we would defend Saudi Arabia and put into effect the sanctions, and the combination of the sanctions and the defense of Saudi Arabia and the world reaction would cause Saddam to withdraw. But at the same time, okay, I was then asked, how would you eject the Iraqis from Kuwait if you had to do it? And I immediately went back and said, I don't have the necessary forces in place to do that. And they said, yeah, but if you had to do it right now with the forces you have, what would you do? So we put together a plan which, based upon the forces that were available at that time, would be the plan that we would have to use. But when that plan was briefed immediately followed by a statement which said, that is not what the Commander-in-Chief of Central Command is recommending. It is a weak plan, and it is not the plan we choose to execute. And here are all the things that are wrong with it, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, and J, and a lot more. And if, in fact, we are serious about in fact, ejecting them from Kuwait, what we need is more forces to be able to execute a proper campaign. So that's the context in which it was given. Okay, it was never a recommendation. It was, you know, we were asked, how would you do it if you had to do it right now? And this was the only thing we had available, but it was certainly not the recommended plan.
Not the recommended plan. That's very interesting for history. And when you came up with the recommendation, I mean, when did you actually conceive Hail Mary, and was your inspiration, as people say, Hannibal at Cannae, or Montgomery versus Rommel, or Manstein of Germany, or who?
I wish I could say it was all of that and a lot more, but it wasn't. No, it was once we knew the forces, once the announcement had been made in Washington of the forces that were going to come over here. Really, it's a very simple solution. You make your plan based upon what we call METT, mission, enemy, terrain, troops available, and time. And so you made an analysis of all those, and the big factor was really the terrain, the troops available, and the enemy. When you looked at the way they were deploying their forces in Kuwait, they had an exposed flank. It was very simple, they had an open flank over there. The terrain on that flank looked like it was trafficable. But we didn't know. We really didn't know whether it was trafficable or not. And secondly, I never, ever believed, well, I couldn't conceive of a commander of any type leaving that flank exposed. So what we really did was, you know, is I looked at the new forces that were available, and I said, all right, if he stays in this configuration that he's in right now, and if that terrain over on the left flank, his right flank, is in fact trafficable, we have a wonderful opportunity to cut off and destroy his forces. And that was sort of the generation of now, we had already done a lot of deception planning that was devised to make him think we were coming from the sea. And his troop disposition was that way. But as you know, once we announced our reinforcement, he announced his reinforcement, and every day more forces were coming in. And I've got to tell you, every morning when I would get out of bed, the first thing I would do is go look at the map to see where his forces were and whether or not he was, in fact, extending his forces further out and, more importantly, building these. See, he started, as soon as he started reinforcing, he also started building very, very heavy obstacles and barriers in front of his forces, which could have given us a lot of problems. But the more you watched his deployment of forces, the more he was stuffing forces into a bag, for all intents and purposes, called Kuwait. And he was not defending that flank. So by, I think the meeting that I had with my, I had a brief meeting with the component commanders in here sometime around the 10th of November, where I said, okay, this is what I think we're going to do. And I said, and then I called another meeting.
So that was 2 days after the president announced the 200,000.
Yeah, yeah, because I, you know, the minute I knew I had the forces, then it was different. And I drew the big arrows on the map and said, this is the plan. And I said, now you got to understand, this is preliminary, and you know, one of the mistakes planners have made in the past is they've forgotten this factor called the enemy. And I said, you know, if the enemy changes, then we may have to change this plan. But right now, this is the way I see it happening. He never changed.
So the tentative approval from the president on October the 30th, the speech November 8th, you were able to talk to people November 10th, and then November 29th, the UN Security Council set the deadline of January the 15th, which made it even more serious from your
point. Yeah, well, see, now the factor of time is in there. Now the clock is ticking under this MET-T. The clock is ticking on you, and one of the questions, you know, you have in your mind is, how quickly are we going to be ready? You know, how quickly can we get these forces from Germany over here? How quickly can we get them acclimated to fighting in the desert? How quickly can I get them in place? But as I say, my concern at that time was, yeah, get the forces over here. But more than anything else, is he going to start building out on that right flank? And I'll tell you, you see, the day we executed the air campaign, I said, we got you. Because, see, then it was impossible after that for them to reinforce that flank. Then they at that time, we had still kept all of our forces over in the east. They had reacted beautifully to all of our forces being in the east. We had nothing in the west. He had not reacted to it in the west. And now I knew that, number one, I could move the forces without him being able to see them. And more importantly, even if he saw them, he couldn't do anything about it because we were going to control the air. And had he tried to go out there and do that, we could have gone ahead. So that's when I knew, we gotcha.
So with the first day of the air war, you had your gotcha. With the second day of the air war, you had one of your worst moments, I would have thought, with the Scud attack on Israel and the fear that Israel might join in.
Yeah, that was a concern. I wouldn't say it was one of the worst moments. I think we all expected the Scud attack on Israel. Then it became a question of how soon can we get it under control? And would Israel be patient enough to allow us to get it under control before they decided to enter into the fray? Because there was no question about the fact that had Israel entered the fray at that moment, it would have put severe pressures on the entire coalition.
Could you have held it together, do you think?
No, I don't think we could have held it all together. I think parts of it would have stayed together, but I don't think... We could not have held it all together, and it certainly would have made... our task much, much more difficult in the long run.
Is there anything that Israel, with its military capacity, could have done that we couldn't do?
Absolutely not. I think they may have thought there was, but I would also say that they did not know everything that we were doing. Nobody knew everything that we were doing except very few people in Washington, and it was even a limited group of people here in this headquarters that knew everything that we were doing. So, and we were very successful, I might add. We not only succeeded in stopping the number of launchings on Israel, but more importantly, what we did is we changed the location from which those launches were taking place, so the launches became highly inaccurate, even much more inaccurate than when they were originally. And by forcing them to launch from from sites that were not pre-surveyed and this sort of thing made a big difference on the accuracy. And that's why the last few Scuds that were launched at Israel were in the wrong places and out in the water or out in the middle of nowhere when they landed.
That's did right. They had more Scud launches than we thought, didn't
yes,
they?
Yes, yeah, they certainly did.
They had, what, 200 rather than 35?
Well, we don't know. I don't think we know. One of the figures I read recently is they had 15 battalions of 15 launchers each, and that adds up, I mean, it multiplies out to be 225, and that was a lot more than we thought, because the maximum estimate that we had had prior to the beginning was 48, and in fact, at one point, right before we launched the hostilities, we had pretty good intelligence that they had a maximum of only 18. So by the time we had destroyed 16 of them, I was feeling pretty confident. As a matter of fact, I made the statement, well, I was limiting my numbers, but I was pretty confident that that we were really doing a job on them. And I think that night, deliberately, they launched a whole salvo to prove me wrong.
How many they got today?
I wish I knew. I have no idea. But I do know that the Scud missile is militarily irrelevant.
Unless they'd been able to put chemical or biological.
Yeah, that would be an entirely different story. But even chemicals, they would have had to do far more than just have a chemical warhead. They would have had to have a chemical warhead with an airburst capability, and they would have had enough accuracy so you see they could fire a salvo of these things in and have them all burst in some sort of a pattern to lay down a large cloud of chemical weapons. That's why we were never really terribly concerned about the chemical capability of the Scud, because even if they had a chemical warhead, and there was a lot of questions whether they did or not, we knew that they didn't have an airburst capability, which meant the missile would have come in, impacted the ground, exploded there, and that would give them a very limited area that those chemicals would affect it.
January the 21st, Iraqi television broadcast those interviews with the captured Allied pilots, obviously most of whom had been brutalized. Can you remember where you saw those pictures, and how you reacted?
Sitting right here looking at that television set right up there. And
how did you react?
Well, I was angry. But I also knew at that time that they were paying a terrible price. And, you know, it was a combination of anger at them for doing that, because it was such a blatant violation of the Geneva Convention, and at the same time compassion for not only the pilots but their families, because you just didn't know what the pilots were going to have to go through. And it was great concern for them too. It was a combination of and I didn't like the idea that I was seeing it on CNN. I will have to state that openly. I did resent CNN aiding and abetting an enemy who was violating the Geneva Convention by putting, that's a clear violation of the Geneva Convention. Yet CNN was broadcasting into the world. That bothers me. But of course, I'm not in the news business, and there's First Amendment rights and the American public's right to know. I just think that, in the future, when people choose to justify their actions based upon the American public's right to know, they better check with the American public first, because the American public's made it very clear to me in all of literally hundreds of thousands of letters I've gotten how they felt about the term, quote, the American people's right to know, as it was being used by the people that were doing that sort of thing.
I think the answer is that the right to know is probably sacred, but there are certain occasions when it has to be delayed.
I would certainly agree with that, particularly when the lives of other Americans hang in the balance.
Now, after the visit of Dick Cheney and Colin Powell, the date was fixed about February the 21st, and then you adjusted it to February 24th. Now, why one date rather than the other?
No, that's not exactly correct. What was decided at that time? It wasn't decided. We discussed it, and it was decided that they would go back and pass on the recommendation of the president that there'd be a window in there. There was a window because there were a lot of last-minute things that were still going on. At the time we briefed them, we were still executing the Hail Mary. I mean, the quarterback was standing behind the ball, but we were still sending the wide receivers out to the left out there. So what I asked for was, I said, you know, give me a little window in there, give me a little slack, and we'll shoot for this sort of window, and that was the recommendation that they made, and again the president was magnificent because he not only agreed to the window, but also the word came back, whatever day you choose, whatever timing you choose, even if it's a little bit later, is fine. So there was no. There wasn't any attempt to second guess or anything like that.
And when you mentioned that the old Hail Mary was going on and so on, when did that exactly start? When did you start moving the people 150 miles?
Well, probably about 0300 hours on the morning of the 17th of January.
As early as that?
Yeah.
Straight away?
Absolutely, because you see, we knew that we were going to establish air superiority immediately. So on the 17th of January, it started. I mean, we needed all of that time. I mean, this was, you know, the tonnage of things that were moved and the amount of transportation that was required, not only just to move the logistics, but to get the troops over there, was huge. So the day we launched the offensive campaign, that was also the day we started moving west.
And then...
The day we launched the air campaign, I'm sorry.
And then, as we move on and you're getting ready, and the date is fixed for February the 24th. It seemed to me one of the most crucial moments in the war was that moment when on the Thursday night before the Sunday, the world was saying that, oh, the president's going to have to accept, the coalition are going to have to accept this unsatisfactory Soviet peace proposal, you know, because the coalition will fall apart and the Cold War will start and all of that. And that seemed to me to be a moment of real character, that the next morning, as the New York Times said, the president reversed the conventional wisdom following a meeting with Colin Powell the night before. That was a crucial moment, wasn't it? Were you worried about those negotiations with the Russians going off at half cock?
No, I don't think the term worried is the right term, you know.
As infuriated with them.
Oh, no, not that at all. No, you know, you we're, as military commanders, you're always on, you have mixed emotions. Your first choice is not to go to war, because you know war kills people. So obviously my first choice all along would be, hey, if we could solve this situation, bring peace to the Middle East and not kill a single soldier, that's the best way to resolve this whole thing. If, on the other hand, we have to go to war, then we don't want our hands tied behind our back. We're going to do it 100% all the way and do whatever is necessary to inflict maximum casualties on the enemy and minimum on our own forces. And that's sort of the two extremes that you're at. You don't like anything that's in between. Now, you may be forced eventually to live with something that's in between, but what you would prefer is one of those two extremes. So when this business was going on about the Soviet proposal and that sort of thing, it looked like it was going to fall someplace in the middle. And although half of you is saying, well, gee, that's great because that doesn't mean a single service member is going to get killed, the other half of you said, yeah, but is that going to accomplish the objectives that we went through all of this deployment over here to accomplish in the first place? And I've got to tell you that I was honestly, you know, torn between those two extremes.
And when you say about inflicting maximum damage and so on, given what you feel about the desirability of a war never taking place, being anti-war, as you were saying, and so on, and you're fierce and in defending the lives of your own soldiers and so on, what attitude does a military man with a conscience like you've got, what attitude do you take to the 50 or 100,000 deaths on the other side? I mean, how does one feel about those when it's all over?
I feel two ways. Number one, I regret the death of anyone. Number two, we only had 150 people killed. And the reason why we only had 150 people killed is because we so fiercely went after them that we struck terror in their hearts. And that resulted in 50,000 or 100,000 or 150 or whatever of them to be killed. I guess I could put it another way. If this battle had gone on for 6 months, there would have been a whole lot more than 50 or 100 or 150. But you don't pursue a battle worried about the casualties you inflict upon the enemy. The war was not our choosing. The war was their choosing. They had ample opportunity to avoid the war. Sherman said, what was it that Sherman said? You know, war is the remedy that our enemy has chosen, therefore let them have as much of it as they want. I think that was his words. I think to be a military commander, you have to have that attitude. And that is, look, war is not of my choosing, but when it comes, my objective is to keep as many of my people alive as I can, and you do that by inflicting the maximum casualties on your enemy. I'm not proud of killing, you know, being responsible for the death of a single person. I never will be. But perhaps by the loss of those lives, we have saved literally hundreds of thousands more in this entire region for many, many years to come. And I like to think of it in those terms.
Did you expect on February the 24th that you'd have it all over in 100 hours?
No, no. My estimate, I knew it could be over in that amount of time, but I really thought it would take about 3 weeks. I thought that we would probably gain great initial surprise. Had they chosen to stand and fight, I'm not too sure that it wouldn't have taken longer. I mean, I'm quite sure it would have taken longer, but my initial estimate was about 2 to 3 weeks.
A really city guy's question. This is a real city guy's question. But it's an amazing triumph. You started, as you said, right back on January the 17th. And you managed to do all that with total surprise, the whole left hook, the whole Hail Mary thing. In that whole area we were taking people through and so on, wasn't there a single Iraqi living there with a telephone who picked up and rang Baghdad 4278 and said, guess I just saw some Americans walking by?
Yeah, but somebody mentioned that to me the other day and said, you know, gee, we had Bedouins wandering through the area. But the secret...
Did we dress as Bedouins?
No. No, but they, I mean, you know, Iraqi Bedouins.
No, but did we disguise ourselves? I mean,
not in this particular area. When you're on the ground, it is very difficult to understand the magnitude of what you are seeing. I mean, you can be driving your sheep through, and all of a sudden you can say, gosh, gee, a whole bunch of trucks here. I mean, if you're not trained, you don't know the difference between a tanker and a tanker. For that matter, a fuel tanker. So, I mean, so as an innocent Bedouin driving your sheep through, you probably say, gee, there's a whole lot of vehicles around here, but you don't understand the magnitude of what you're looking at. It's only when you get up in the air, way up in the air, and you look down and you say, holy smokes, not only are there a whole bunch of tanks there, but there's a whole bunch of tanks over here, and there's a whole bunch of tanks over there, and you add it all up, and then all of a sudden, the magnitude of the force. And you see, I think that was, the Iraqis knew we were out there because we had had border skirmishes and this sort of thing. And certainly the week before, we had gone ahead and prepared the area for where we were going to attack. So they knew we were out there. But they didn't know we were out there with two full corps. I mean, the maximum of our combat power was out to the west, not directly in front of them. But two full corps, the total of 8 divisions were out there.
How were you consulted about the ceasefire? I mean, how did it happen?
Well, you know, General Powell and I talked to each other several times a day, every day, on where I was keeping him very closely advised on what was going on here. He was keeping me very closely advised as to what was going on in Washington. And, of course, more importantly, he was keeping the Secretary of Defense and the President very closely advised on a daily basis. And so once, after the third day, as I say, we knew we had them. I mean, we had closed the back door. The bridges across the Tigris and Euphrates were out. We had cut Highway 8 that ran up the Tigris and Euphrates Valley on this side of the river. There was no way out for them. I mean, they could go through Basra. There were a few bridges going across the Al-Faw. There was to the Al-Faw, but there was nothing else. And it was literally about to become the Battle of Cannae, a battle of annihilation. So we were driving into their flank now with two corps completely intact, and they were in complete rout. And I reported that situation to General Powell, and he and I discussed, have we accomplished our military objectives, the campaign objectives? And the answer was yes. You know, there was no question about the fact that the campaign objectives that we established for ourselves were accomplished. The enemy was being kicked out of Kuwait, was going to be gone from Kuwait. We had destroyed the Republican Guard as a militarily effective force.
Had you totally destroyed it? I mean, in the sense, well, Egypt and Syria wanted to carry on and destroyed a bit more, didn't
well,
they?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a question of how do you define the word destroy? Yeah. The Republican Guard was a militarily ineffective force, and we had inflicted great damage upon them, and they had been routed. Now, obviously, you know, we didn't destroy them to the very last tank. And again, this is a point that I think may be lost on a lot of people. That was a very courageous decision on the part of the president to also stop the offensive. You know, we didn't declare a ceasefire. What we did is we suspended offensive operations. Frankly, my recommendation had been, you know, continue to march. I mean, we had them in a rout, and we could have continued to, you know, reap great destruction upon them. We could have completely closed the door and made it, in fact, a battle of annihilation. And the president, you know, made the decision that, you know, that we should stop at a given time, at a given place. That did leave some escape routes open for them to get back out, and I think it was a very humane decision and a very courageous decision on his part also. Because it's, you know, it's one of those ones that historians are going to second guess, you know, forever. Why didn't we go for one more day versus why did we stop when we did, when we had them completely routed? We're already getting the questions, well, they really weren't there in as much force as they said they were because you've only captured X number, you've only got Y number of estimated dead, and therefore it doesn't compute. Well, there were obviously a lot of people that escaped who wouldn't have escaped if the decision hadn't been made, you know, to stop us right where we were at that time. But again, I think that was a very courageous decision on the part of the president.
A very courageous decision and a very real debate, really, that between, on the one hand, completely dispensing with the Republican Guard so it could never be used again, as you were recommending, another 24 hours, versus the humanitarian decision. That is one of the, as you say, that is one of the great decisions of history.
Yeah.
Which way to do that?
I don't think you should put it in the context of the Republican Guard because they, remember, were the ones who were mostly to the rear, and a lot of them had bugged out already. I mean, they had long since, I think once they discovered that their flank up Route 8 was blocked, and they weren't going to, I think some of them had already long since escaped. As a matter of fact, they were north of the river, and we probably could have, had we gone on for another 24 hours, we could have inflicted terrible damage on them with air attacks and that sort of thing on the far side of the river, but nowhere near the devastation we were inflicting on, and the troops on this side of the river, because, of course, the tank columns were just ripping through them at that time. But the forces that we really had trapped in that pocket were all the forces that were all the way down into Kuwait and were still trying to desperately retreat out of this very, very small route of escape that was left open to them. And so I think we probably would have inflicted a lot more damage probably on the poor fellows that had been all the way down in the front lines and had managed to get all the way back there and were still there than it would have been actually the Republican Guard. I think they had pretty well bugged out by that time.
So will the phrase that we read so often, the elite Republican Guard, go down in history as one of the most inaccurate cliches of all time?
Elite is a relative word, okay? compared to the forces that we had arrayed against them, they definitely were not elite.
When you went to the talks about the ceasefire and so on, and you made those arrangements, looking back now, what angers you most about their infractions or breaches? Is it to do with the use of helicopters to suppress the civilian population? Is it the reports of napalm? What breaches of what they promised you that day anger you most?
Now, let me make very clear that this is Norm Schwarzkopf's personal opinion,
right,
okay, and certainly not a position of the government or anything like that. I think they suckered me. I think that when they asked me to use helicopters, at that time, you see, nothing was flying over Iraq. And we had said, you will not fly over Iraq. And they looked me straight in the eye and said, well, you know, you've destroyed all of our bridges. You know, you've destroyed all of our roads. And therefore, it's hard to get around the country. We would like to fly our helicopters. And the purpose of flying those helicopters will be for transportation of government officials. It seemed like, given my marching orders, which was to make sure that we were establishing measures that would prevent a furtherance of conflict, you know, that would avoid a furtherance of unnecessary bloodshed, and to dictate rather strong terms to them of what they would have to do. I was really interested in two things. First, in getting the POWs back as fast as we possibly could. And then secondly, setting up certain demarcation lines and that sort of thing so that the conflict would not continue inadvertently by accident. Now, those were really the two primary things. So when they said to me, we would like to fly helicopters, I said, not over our forces. Oh, no, definitely not over your forces. Just over Iraq, because for the transportation of government officials, that seemed like a reasonable request, and within my charter, I felt that that was something that it was perfectly all right to grant. I think I was suckered, because I think they intended right then when they asked that question to use those helicopters against the insurrections that were going on. I think it absolutely was their intention. Again, personal opinion, but I just, as I say, they suckered me.
So even in defeat, you can't trust Saddam Hussein. And there'll be no real ceasefire, will there, until he goes? Really? A genuine one, will there?
There will be a ceasefire. They wouldn't dare attack us or anyone else right now. First of all, there's such chaos in their own country that they got to get the home front straightened out. So the ceasefire is in effect as far as them attacking us and taking any overt action against us. However, we're not going to let down our guard. We're going to continue to do exactly what we told them we were going to do. And if they violate those rules and in any way threaten us, even in the slightest, they're going to pay for it. We're not going to tolerate any situation that would endanger our forces. But on the other hand...
So we wouldn't rule out... I mean, if he's listening to this, I mean, we wouldn't rule out a bombing raid if we had to protect our boys. We wouldn't rule out a bit more territory if we had to protect
our boys. Remember, we don't have a ceasefire. We have a unilateral cessation of offensive actions on the part of the coalition. And we agreed at Safwan that if they abided by the conditions that we set down, that we would continue with that unilateral cessation of offensive operations. The ceasefire has not been declared. They've declared a ceasefire. Of course, I would too if I had been routed and was on the run and say, hey, we've... And they kept using the term at Safwan ceasefire, and I kept saying, this is not a ceasefire. What it is we have chosen to suspend offensive operations. But I think a more important thing is when you go back and look at Saddam Hussein's record... He's lied at every turn. He has never stopped lying. And so therefore, we're not about to, and they've told us on several other occasions since then, oh, you have to trust us. And you're almost tempted to come back and say, why? You know, why should we trust you at all, given the long-established record of lies that you have behind you? So we're not going to trust them. We're going to continue to keep our guard up until such time as there is, in fact, a ceasefire that's been declared. And we are very, very sure that no one, absolutely no one out there on the battlefield is going to take offensive action against us. And I mean anyone who does is going to pay a price for it.
There'll be a ceasefire, but there won't be peace, I guess, until Saddam Hussein goes, probably would be a more accurate quote.
I think that...
peace.
I would not speak for all the leadership of the Gulf nations, but I think that they're going to be much more comfortable when Saddam is gone, because Saddam is Iraq. As far as the actions of the Iraqi government, they are the actions and orders of one man, Saddam. And he is the one that has inflicted the Iran-Iraq war on the Gulf. He is the one that has inflicted this catastrophic occurrence in Kuwait. He is the one that has inflicted the ecological disaster, not just one, but two. The oil spill, deliberate oil release into the Gulf, number one, which has done just devastating things to the Gulf fisheries and that sort of thing, an unforgivable act of ecological terrorism. And then if you go to Kuwait and see what they've done to the air that the world is going to breathe for many years to come by this senseless destruction of the oil wells and the setting of the oil wells on fire, just spewing black smoke into the air, not only for Kuwait, but for the whole world. It's going to cause agricultural disasters in many areas. It's certainly going to contaminate the air of the world for, I would guess, years to come. So all of that is Saddam Hussein. His orders caused that to happen.
And when you list all those things that Saddam Hussein was responsible for, has been responsible for, I know there's all sorts of academic discussion that can go on between history professors for decades about Nuremberg trials and war crimes trials and so on. But if after that list that we've just been talking about, Saddam Hussein got off scot-free, it wouldn't be right, would it?
Again, this is my personal opinion. As you know, it's differentiated from any official position. He's not going to get off. As I say, philosophically, the man is a war criminal by any definition you choose to apply. Practically, it is difficult to see a Nuremberg trial-type scenario unfolding, given the limited military objectives, given the fact that we didn't take over the entire country of Iraq. It was never our intention to do that. Given the point at which this campaign terminated, practically it is difficult to see a war. I cannot envision a government of Iraq handing over a Saddam to the world court to do something. I may be proven wrong, but I guess philosophically I certainly agree with you, but practically what normally happens to people like Saddam Hussein is at some point they are taken care of by their own folks.
Good and evil, the greatest moral challenge since World War II, and so on. As a result of all those phrases, did you feel, you're a religious man, aren't you?
Yes.
Did you feel that God was on your side in this war?
He had to be. The results show that he had to be. I mean, I've got to tell you, probably the two of the greatest days of my life was day one of the bombing campaign, when the planes came home, and we realized yes, we were successful, and that was very important, but far more important to me, once we had achieved that success, was the fact that we did it with so little loss of human life. And then I'll never forget, as long as I live, Gary Luck, the commander of the 18th Airborne Corps, which was the furthest west corps that absolutely charged out across, and we were in the Euphrates Valley. And Gary called me on the phone and we were talking and he said, well, I want to report to you. And I said, what's your report? And he said, well, we've captured 3,200 prisoners so far and they're just streaming in and we've accomplished all of our objectives and we're in the Euphrates Valley with the 101st. And I said, okay, fine. And I was waiting for the other shoe to fall. And he said, now let me tell you about our casualties. And I said, okay. He said, we have one wounded in action. I mean, now, can you imagine? One wounded in action at that time. Now, we had more after that. But, I mean, you know, I care a lot about my troops. I really do, our troops. And I'm no different than the other commander out there, but I do care, you know, intensely about the soldiers and sailors and airmen, and I feel a tremendous responsibility for their lives. And you can imagine how that made me feel, that here we were not only winning this war, but we were routing the enemy, absolutely routing the enemy. And yet, you know, our casualties were, you know, practically non-existent. And, you know, that made you kind of feel that God wasn't on your side, had to be on your side for that to happen.
You had the Bible I keep reading everywhere beside your bed.
Yeah.
Did you have a favorite text?
There is a prayer attributed to St. Francis, you know, that starts off, Dear Lord, make us instruments of your peace. And that's probably the one I read the most often.
Absolutely. What's the greatest lesson you've learned out of all this?
I think there's so many lessons, but I think that the there's one really fundamental military truth, and that's that you can add up the correlation of forces, you can look at the number of tanks, you can look at the number of airplanes, you can look at all of these factors of military might and put them together, but unless the soldier on the ground or the airman in the air has the will to win, has the strength of character to go into battle, believes that his cause is just, and has the support of his country. Unless you have that, all the rest of that stuff is irrelevant. Because by, it's just like Hannibal. I mean, Hannibal never should have gone across the Alps if he looked at the correlation of forces and the number of chariots. Okay. Alexander the Great never should have left Macedonia. Certainly at the Battle of Arbela, he never should have taken on Xerxes, ever. I mean, if he looked at all the chariots and everything else that Xerxes had, and look. But the difference was really, when you get right down to it, it was the fighting spirit of the individual going into combat. And you see, I'm convinced that because of the support of the world, that our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines from the entire coalition knew that they had behind them. That gave them a great, great advantage that the Iraqi forces didn't have.
And even with greater technology and so on, the will to win, the will of the individual soldier remains preeminent. Barry McCaffrey, I think, said it. If they'd had all our weapons and we'd had theirs, we'd still have won. Is that true?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because, you see, they chose not to stay and fight. That's why when the armchair strategists are now all saying, well, obviously there couldn't be as many people there because the war was over so quickly. They could have had 10 times more people. But the people have to decide to stay and fight. If they don't, you know, a football game can be over very quickly if the other team decides not to play. And that's what you had in this case. I mean, when the kickoff came, okay, our team was there to play. Our team came to play ball, and they were not willing to fight.
And when you look at your philosophy of life and so on, some people might, and your feeling about being anti-war and so on, and being, you quoted, I think it was Robert E. Lee, about the fact that you have to kill those you love the most, that you're in a kill and be killed sort of profession, and yet you hate war and so on, and you hate death, and you hate the loss of life. Do you sometimes think it's a paradox that you're doing what you're doing?
No. I'm an idealist. I think of myself as an idealist, and there are some things worth fighting for. There's a great poem, not a great poem. There was a play called Franklin in Paris, and Franklin in Paris was about Benjamin Franklin, and it was on during the Vietnam War years, and it's probably one of my very favorite quotes. And just to extract from it, you know, Benjamin Franklin's talking about a fly that was in a bottle of Madeira wine. And came back to life 200 years later when it was poured out of the Madeira wine. And he goes on to talk about how wonderful it would be to be pickled in a cask of Madeira wine for 200 years and then come back. And what he says in that soliloquy that's delivered at the very end of this play is, you know, 200 years, I wonder how I should find them then. Those men to whom the word American is not new, would they love liberty having been given an outright from the crib for nothing? And would they understand that if you are not free, you are lost without faith? And it goes on to say, and will they be willing to strive to preserve these ideals as we strove to plant them? That all men are created equal and that each is endowed with certain inalienable rights. And it finishes off and says, and would they die for them? For that is the question one must ultimately ask oneself, would I die for it? And the answer must be yes, sir, I would. That sums it up. There are certain things out there, none of us want to die, but there are certain things out there worth fighting for. And I think family, I would die for my family tomorrow to protect my family, and I think most people would. And I think liberty, freedom, you know, there are some things out there that you have to be willing to die for.
In conclusion, General, let's just revert back to something that we've been able to rejoice about two or three times in the course of this conversation, which was that our casualties were much lower than we were led to fear in advance. But as you said in your that magnificent press briefing you gave, The statistics were miraculous, but they weren't miraculous for those who were killed in action.
No. And I grieve for every one of those families. And I still grieve. We're still losing people out there. And, you know, every human life is special. And so I do grieve for those families, and I always will.
Well, the Defense Department have supplied us with a list of those people we lost, killed in action, and may I suggest that's the way we end this hour?
I think that'd be a great ending.